He is called the weeping prophet. In other words, he wept a lot. Now, we get that terminology from the book of Lamentations, which we're studying today, chapters 1 to 3. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Rod Hembree.
And I'm Janice.
And this is Quick Study Television, a program designed to take you through the Bible. As we go through Lamentations, it is a very interesting time. Corey, what's up?
Today, I'm going to be taking a look at acrostic poetry because Lamentations is written in an acrostic style.
Excellent. Very good. Look forward to that. What did you do today?
Today, we're going to talk about one of my favorite verses in Lamentations 3.
Your favorite verses?
One of my favorite verses.
In Lamentations. Uh-huh. All right. Very good. And Ryan is here to tell us what he's doing. Ryan, what's up?
Today, in part two of our study of ancient Roman technology, we're featuring what could be called one of the most iconic symbols of Imperial Rome, the Colosseum.
All right, get your Bible guide, turn to today's page, and get your Bible out because it's time to study. This is a good one today.
The biblical book of Lamentations was the official reaction of the prophet Jeremiah to the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple of God in Jerusalem. So today you and I are going to be focusing in on the book of Lamentations, but stylistically speaking. So Lamentations is written as an acrostic poem. So it's poetry arranged in an alphabetical way. Take a look at this.
Acrostic poetry has an alphabetic structure. In the Bible, these acrostics artfully work their way through the 22-letter Hebrew alphabet. They can be found in the books of Psalms, Proverbs, Song of Solomon, and Lamentations. Most often in the Bible, acrostic poems see each new verse begin with a successive letter of the Hebrew alphabet. But there are variations. Sometimes every other verse begins with a new letter, or each half of a verse. In the case of Psalm 119, each letter of the alphabet has a whole stanza dedicated to it, with each verse in the stanza beginning with that letter. Due to its nature as an alphabetic poem, acrostic poetry only occurs in literate societies. These poems are arranged around an alphabet. Their very existence depends on the society having an alphabet with a set order that the audience knows and recognizes. Acrostic poetry is also very ancient. Evidence for them outside of the Bible has been found dating back to 1300 BC. While everyone agrees that acrostics are fully functional, carefully thought-out poetry, scholars seem to disagree over their meaning. Why would authors choose to limit themselves to this alphabetical structure? There are many answers. Perhaps the acrostic style was simply a framework that sets the stage for at least 22 lines of text. Maybe its generic structure allowed a creative writing talent to truly shine, or perhaps it was used to help with memorization. More interesting answers are also possible. For example, in Proverbs 31's acrostic poem describing the work of an ideal wife, she is shown to have every angle covered for her family. The acrostic style, then, going from A to Z, implies that completeness. She has everything from A to Z under control. This use of structuring a poem to add or complement the meaning has also caused some scholars to reconsider poems in the Bible that are missing a letter or have an added letter. These could be written off as textual corruptions, but it's at least possible that the author purposefully chose to break the mold of the structure he chose in order to add another dimension of meaning to his work.
So acrostic poetry, or the acrostic style for poetry, was extremely popular for a broad variety of applications, but it was popular also in this weeping, lament, grief genre as well. Now, one of the reasons that scholars believe that it was applied to books like Lamentations was to emphasize how emotional the book actually was. And that might sound a little bit counterintuitive at first, because a lot of times we think of grief and emotion as very free-flowing. But the concept behind using a structure, a very rigid structure like the alphabet, like acrostic poetry, and applying it to grief, is the concept behind that would be that you're so emotional, it would be impossible to really fully explain how you're feeling. So by using a structure, by using guidelines, you're actually keeping yourself accountable to speak. You're getting yourself to the next letter so that you can speak. It provides a structure or a window for your emotional grief. So this is one of the ideas that scholars have been playing around with for explaining why the acrostic style is used often in the ancient world to express grief. And it's used here in the Book of Lamentations extremely effectively. So the fact that Jeremiah used this structure to explain grief, you know, it's a really kind of cool symbiotic thing with the ancient world.
Lamentations is a funeral dirge, a script displaying the truth about Jerusalem and its people. Now, they were people called to know the Lord, but in their life's work, they ended it in captivity because they failed the law of God. Now, God knew this when he gave them his commandments hundreds of years before they were sent into bondage. Why does God allow this to take place? I mean, does he love to see their failure and their pain? Is God an angry God? Is he a mad God? Perhaps he knew that he would have to provide a different way. The people were under sin through their own fault and could not bear the law as it was given to them in a covenant with Moses. God knows our failures and our weaknesses, yet he calls us to follow Jesus Christ. That's his plan of salvation.
Lamentations 3, verses 1 through 15. I am the man who has seen affliction by the rod of his wrath. He has led me and made me walk in darkness and not in light. Surely he has turned his hand against me time and time again throughout the day. He has aged my flesh and my skin and broken my bones. He has besieged me and surrounded me with bitterness and woe. He has set me in dark places like the dead of long ago. He has hedged me in so that I cannot get out. He has made my chain heavy. Even when I cry and shout, he shuts out my prayer. He has blocked my ways with hewn stone. He has made my paths crooked. He has been to me a bear lying in wait like a lion in ambush. He has turned aside my ways and torn me in pieces. He has made me desolate. He has bent his bow and set me up as a target for the arrow. He has caused the arrows of his quiver to pierce my loins. I have become the ridicule of all my people, their taunting song all the day. He has filled me with bitterness. He has made me drink wormwood. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 1 through 15.
You know, the book of Jeremiah is an interesting book. It's 52 chapters long, and that's great, or 52 chapters in the book of Jeremiah. And Lamentations is also written by Jeremiah. It's a funeral song for Jerusalem and Judah. And in Lamentations, he is saying, Lord, why has this happened? Why has this happened to Judah? Why has this happened to Jerusalem? And it really is interesting. In chapter 3, it says, I am the man who has seen affliction. Jeremiah says, under the rod of his wrath, he has driven and brought me into darkness without light. Can you believe that? I mean, Jeremiah is living through this again. That's why he's called the weeping prophet. Beloved, as we continue in the book, we need to understand that Lamentations is really a part of Jeremiah. Jeremiah and Lamentations really are together. And as we read that, we will understand it in such a way. Now, our ways of truth are interesting because in this episode, our ways of truth are the weeping prophet. And the weeping prophet being, of course, Jeremiah, we have a chance to hear his words in Lamentations, the first three chapters. We're looking at Lamentations 1 to 3, and we're looking at Lamentations chapter 3, verses 1 to 15. This is a funeral dirge. So, Father, I pray today in the name of Jesus Christ, as we read through Lamentations, as we understand what it says, help us to hear your words. Help us to understand and have the courage to live and do what you say. In the name of Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, and all of us said together, amen. Now, when we look at it, we begin to ask questions at the beginning. You know, why is this guy so depressed? But we must understand what he's doing. He is lamenting over Jerusalem. Look at Lamentations 3, verse 1. It says, I am the man who has seen affliction by the rod of his wrath. The rod of his, capital H, wrath. So God's wrath has done this. He has led me and made me walk in darkness and not in light. Surely God has turned his hand against me time and time again throughout the day. He has aged my flesh and my skin and broken my bones. He has besieged me and surrounded me with bitterness and woe. He has set me in a dark place like the dead of long ago. I mean, this is a depressing feeling. But remember that the man of God was defeated because of the God he serves. But there is a difference between where we were and where God has brought us now. Now, if you're a Christian, if you're somebody who has invited Jesus Christ into your heart, you understand what that was like. You understand what it was like to be in the bondage of sin. But when you came out of that bondage, man, it was great. And you have no problem declaring an enemy on sin because sin was not really that good. In fact, it was devastating. And that's true. Now, for a time, sin will be nice, but there comes a time when sin uses up all of the things that it pleases. And you can't understand what that's like until you've come to it. And when you have, you invite Jesus Christ into your life through the Word of God, and you say, Lord, be the Lord of my life, and God takes that sin off of you. That's a different place to be than here. Look at verse 7. It says, He has hedged me in so that I cannot get out. He has made my chain heavy. Even when I cry and shout, he shuts out my prayer. He has blocked my ways with hewn stone. He has made my paths crooked. Isn't that interesting? Again, there is nothing we can do about our sin. Nothing. We can only be saved if we look to Jesus Christ. Here it says and tells us that there's nothing anyone can do about the sin. Now, sin is that thing that emanates from Satan. And Adam and Eve, who were real people at the beginning of time, were told, as soon as you take from the fruit of the tree of knowledge and good and evil in Genesis chapter 3, he says, you know what? You're going to die. Sin's going to be a problem. So death is not a part of life, but death is a result of sin. For the wages of sin are death. But the gift of God is eternal life. That's what the scripture tells us, beloved. So we need to understand that through Jesus Christ, the power of God, the Son of God, we can invite him into our life to be the Lord of our life. When we do that, we're forgiven of our sin, and God helps us, even though we're not perfect. A lot of people think that Christians are perfect. They're not perfect. Nobody's perfect. But what we do is we change our attitude against sin. Not for sin, but against sin. And we begin a journey after salvation, a journey of justification that God helps us with through our life. Very important. Look at the next scripture. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 10. He has been to me a bear lying in wait, like a lion in ambush. He has turned aside my ways and torn me into pieces. He has made me desolate. He has bent his bow and set me up as a target for the arrow. He has caused the arrow of his quiver to pierce my loins. I have become the ridicule of my people, their taunting song all the day. He has filled me with bitterness. He has made me drink wormwood. Man, you see, there is nothing good about sin. You know, it's very important we understand that because it's destructive. But with Jesus Christ, there is everlasting life. The wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23 says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. Very important that we understand that scripture today. Now, if you are in a place right now and you feel the heaviness, the burden of sin, the terror of all the things happening to you, let me give you good news. The good news is that Jesus Christ says, if you ask, I will forgive you. And if you invite me into your life, I will be the Lord of your life and you will be saved. And I want to tell you something. When that happens, there's a lot of things that change. You simply pray. And pray is talking to God. And you communicate with the Lord God and you say, Father in heaven, forgive me of my sin. I believe that Jesus Christ, he died on the cross 2,000 years ago, but he miraculously rose from the dead to pay the cost of sin and give me the gift of eternal life. I believe that. Help my unbelief. So I give you my life today. Help me, Lord. Forgive me of my sin. I need you now. In Jesus' wonderful and powerful name. And everyone said together, amen. We learn from Lamentations chapter 5 that we really only can go to God. And so we figure that out. Help us, Lord, to do that. And we'll talk about that next time on Quick Study Television, a very important day. Right now, here's Ryan. Ryan, what's up?
Well, today we continue in our study of Roman technology. Yesterday, we looked at the fascinating and highly impressive Lycurgus cup. And today, we look at another piece of amazing Roman technology, albeit a much larger piece of technology. In fact, it's considered one of the most iconic symbols of Imperial Rome, the Colosseum. Although partially in ruins now due to earthquake damage and stone robbers, the Colosseum is still an iconic symbol of Imperial Rome. Emperor Vespasian had given the order to build the massive amphitheater, then called Amphitheatrum Flavium, and construction began in AD 72. Interestingly, it was funded with the precious metals and materials the Romans had sacked from the Jewish temple during the famous siege of AD 70. And in fact, it would be 12,000 Jewish captives who would be the ones forced to build it. It was an 8-year project requiring more than 6,000 tons of concrete and very large stone blocks, which were quarried 20 miles away. Unlike many earlier amphitheaters, which had been dug into hillsides to provide adequate support, the Colosseum was a freestanding structure. The distinctive exterior had 3 stories of arched entrances, a total of around 80, supported by semicircular columns. In fact, its outer wall is estimated to have used over 3.5 million cubic feet of travertine stone, held together with iron clamps rather than mortar. By the end of it, the colossal building rose to a height of 160 feet and stretched 620 feet long and 513 feet wide,
making it the largest and tallest Roman building ever. Indeed, the Colosseum could seat upwards of 80,000 people and had many features of a modern-day stadium. Tickets, for example, much like today, were used for designated seating. Also inside were 110 drinking fountains and two large restrooms to accommodate the fans. Roman engineers even designed a retractable roof, which could be raised and adjusted to control light and airflow. Also, like our stadiums today, with such massive crowds, quick evacuation of the venue was essential. Interestingly, the Roman architects adopted solutions very similar to those used in modern stadiums to deal with the same problem. The amphitheater was ringed by 80 entrances at ground level, 76 of which were used by ordinary spectators. But the most astonishing component of the Colosseum was its water feature. Indeed, in addition to the gladiatorial contests and the reenactments of famous battles and dramas based on classical mythology, mock sea battles also took place. For this, the arena was completely flooded. A nearby aqueduct supplied the water, and when the battle was finished, it was expelled through pipes connected directly to the city's sewer system. Though now somewhat ravaged by time, this masterfully engineered amphitheater still stands witness to the intelligence of the ancient Romans, for the Colosseum is still considered a wonder to this day.
Really, as we've studied the technology which ancient man has created, we've seen that there's no way that they were any less intelligent than we are today. This, of course, does not compute for those committed to evolution. For those of us committed to the Bible, however, ancient technology such as this isn't really all that surprising. Of course, ancient people were intelligent. They were created in the image of God, just like you and me.
Yeah, it's very interesting, Ryan, that we see all this technology in the past and proof that the people were very sophisticated. They weren't just animals, but they were very sophisticated.
Yeah, law codes and the whole civilizations, right? I mean, come on.
Okay.
Let's get real.
I hear you, man. That's great. What did you do today?
Well, you know, we're taking a look at Lamentations. It's written by Jeremiah, and really it's a funeral song. And some would say, well, how come you have a favorite verse in a funeral song? But I actually do. And when we take a look at this chapter in Lamentations, we really see or hear and can feel the depth of Jeremiah's sorrow. And especially when we get down to verse 19, he's saying, "Remember my affliction and roaming, the wormwood and the gall. My soul still remembers and sinks within me." And then all of a sudden there's a switch and he says, "This I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope." And here comes one of my favorite verses. "Through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And then it goes on. "The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in him." And it goes on. "The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord." Jeremiah goes from thinking of all of those deep things that have brought him despair and sorrow, and then quickly he reminds himself that the Lord is good. And really, that's the heart of this book. It's talking about the faithfulness of God. And sometimes when we get in those low points in our lives, or we have to make deep decisions that will have great impact on our lives and the people around us, we can get caught in those deep, dark thoughts. And create a world that is dark and deep. But when we remember that God's mercies and God's faithfulness is new every morning, it's like the setting and the rising of the sun. God is so steady. He's never changing. And that God that was here for Jeremiah is still here for us today. And so when we get in those dark times when we don't know what we're going to do, or everything feels like it's caving out around us, or our foundations are shaking, let's all remember that great are God's mercies, and his faithfulness is brand new every single morning, just like the rising of the sun. And when we learn to praise him all the time, like the psalmist reminds us so many times in the Psalms, when we can do that, when we can praise God in all times, we can rise ourselves up. You can feel the change in the tone in Jeremiah's heart right here between verses 19 and 20. You can feel it switch. And that's what we need to remember as well, to encourage one another that God is faithful and that he is merciful to us.
Yeah, it's that hope in his character.
Exactly. Yeah. And that really builds our faith.
It does.
Because it's not us that gets stronger. It's God who is stronger in us because we see his faithfulness play out in our lives. And it's amazing. We're not talking about a dead God. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about a figment of our imagination. We are talking about a living God who loves us so much that he gave. How did he give? He sent his son so that there wouldn't be any more separation between us and him. And that we have that renew every morning. You know, there's lots of times I wake up at night, and there's a lot of women that I talk to as well, and they're up at night. And I'll tell you, things seem a lot worse in the nighttime.
They do.
In the dark hours.
They do.
And you can stew and worry about it. And it's sometimes it's hard to give those things over to the Lord, you know? Sometimes it really is a giving action where you really physically have to give these things over to God. But somehow when that sun rises in the morning, it's not so bad. Mm-hmm. And we need to learn to praise God in all things. And I'm speaking to myself as well, because there's lots of times when I have to remind myself to do that, just like Jeremiah did here.
Mm-hmm. Great is thy faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness.
And that song, Great is thy faithfulness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And
mm-hmm.
all of that proves to us and shows us and tells us that God is faithful.
He is.
I think as human beings on this planet, of course, it's when you're young and all of that, it's very easy to be excited about life. But then when you start moving along in life and you get like our age, you know, 50s, you start asking yourself the questions, what am I doing? Unless you have the Lord in your life, unless you have God inside saying to you and explaining to you what your, you know, what your calling is and all of that, you have to revisit that.
And you know what? It's not just older people. It's the younger generation who look around and sometimes they feel very hopeless. And don't let that be a lie into your life. There is hope. God is our hope, and he has a future and a purpose for you. You are not a mistake. You were designed and you are loved by God. So press forward. There is hope. Meet Jesus Christ. You might have heard about him, but you don't know him. Talk to him and call out to him today. Ask God to come into your heart, and he will make himself known to you. You have hope and you have a future.
I think it's important that we pray, Father, in Jesus' name, by the power of your Holy Spirit, open up the hearts of individuals who need to feel your faithfulness, who need to understand who you are. They may have been depressed or whatever, but Lord, you can help them. Come into their heart now and help them in Jesus' name.